Hello and welcome to this exam question video. We're looking at AQA GCSE PE today and we're in this past paper looking at question 19.2 and 19.3 because they go quite nicely hand in hand. And what it's asking us is to identify the type of lever from this image up here. Now this could be from any sporting context, but you need to be able to sort of analyze a movement, work out what joint is moving and articulating, what muscles and agonists and antagonists are in action, and then from that, you'll be able to work out the lever system in play. So we're looking at this forehand tennis stroke, and we're looking to identify the type of lever being used at the elbow. And then at the end, what we'll do is look at how to label, not just this lever, but all three of them. So we're gonna jump into the whiteboard just to make this a little bit clearer. And firstly, what we're gonna put onto the board here is a little rhyme, which we can remember, which can help us remember the lever systems, which is FLE123. Now in this little rhyme, we get, well, three pieces of information. We get the different systems there are, there's three different systems. We get the three components of the system, and we get the order that these components should go in to comprise a specific type of lever. So three things from this little rhyme: the components, how many there are, and what order the components go in to make up different systems. And what we notice is that the letter corresponds to the central component. So a first class lever system, the number one, is a lever system where the fulcrum is in the middle. A second class lever system is when the load is in the middle, and the third class lever system is when the effort is in the middle. So if we were to just sort of picturize these to start with, so we'll go with the first class lever system, and we start with the fulcrum in the middle, which is our F. We then have the rigid bar, and then the other two components, the load and the effort, they can go in either order. It doesn't matter which way around they go, you just need to draw it so that the system makes sense. So obviously the load is where gravity or resistance would be acting, so the load would be working down on this side. And in order to pull a bone, in order to overcome this, this resistance, obviously we would either want to be pulling downwards on this side in order to move this load upwards, or it would be pulling from the other side if we were to be lowering it down. But we're not concerned about that. We're concerned about overcoming the resistance. So we would have the effort over here, the load on this side, and the fulcrum in the middle for a first class lever system. If it were a second class lever, then we need to put the load into the middle. So we draw the load first, and we know that's going to be acting downwards through the rigid bar of the bone. And then it doesn't matter which end the other two go. So if we draw the fulcrum at this end, so that pivot point, and in order to overcome the resistance, there's no point pulling the effort down through the bar. We would be pulling away and upwards so that we can sort of lever this box, this load, upwards off the ground. Now, it's important to note in sort of everyday life, this effort could be applied from underneath. So we could draw it from that direction. But this would be, for example, a wheelbarrow where a person is pushing upwards from underneath the metal structure and pushing with effort upwards through that end. But in the body, muscles can only pull on a bone. They can only shorten in order to move the bone. They can lengthen to allow for movement during eccentric contractions, but what we're concerned more about here is overcoming a resistance in concentric contraction. So a muscle can't push, it can only pull. So the way that I picture lever systems in the body is that this arrow is in fact the muscle tendon. So the rigid line is the bone. The point of contact is the insertion or the origin of the muscle tendon on the bone itself. And then the arrow is, well, the tendon and the muscle. So if we were to contract this green arrow and shorten it in on itself, what would happen? Well, it would lift upwards and the bar would move with it, as would the load. So a way to remember it is to draw the arrow going away from this rigid bar, because that's how muscles in the body work. Now in everyday life, an effort could be working in the direction of the metal bar, but muscles don't do that. So insert the tendon onto the bone and then pull it away. And then if we were to do that, obviously this would be system number one, would be like a catapult. And system number two is a bit like a wheelbarrow if you were to pull upwards from above that metal structure. And the same goes for our third class lever. So third class, we're looking to have the effort in the middle. So we have our rigid bar, we have our effort pulling this bone upwards, and then for it to make sense, the fulcrum is obviously underneath, and the load would be on top with gravity working down. So the load would be there, the effort would be in the middle as per our rhyme, and our fulcrum would be here at the end. So the tennis stroke. Well, if we draw that action out, so if we quickly go back to the question itself, identify the type of lever being used at the elbow during the forehand tennis stroke. So from position A through to position B, we're talking about elbow flexion. So if we come back now and think about what an elbow does in order to flex or to decrease that angle, we quickly draw the bones and the bones themselves. We've got the humerus up at the top here, and then we've got the radius slash ulna as part of the lower arm. Now on top, we would have the bicep, on top of the humerus, and most importantly, the tendon of the bicep inserts onto the articulating bone there. So that point of contact, which we've spoken about here, and here, and here, that point of contact, and then the direction of that pull is that arrow. So we know that that there is the effort part of this lever system. Now, what about everything else? Well, we know that the elbow joint is here, because that is where the radius is going to be pivoting on the end of the humerus. And we know that the racket, or the hand, or the resistance, is going to be at the other end of the bone. So if we were to take a bit of a zoom in on that, what would we be looking at? We'd be looking at the radius ulna, we'd be looking at the hand, slash racket, slash ball, slash shot, slash resistance. We've got the effort in the middle, and we've got the fulcrum at the end. So if the effort is in the middle, FLE123, we know it's the third class lever system. The load is at this end, and the fulcrum is there. So tennis stroke, or the forehand tennis stroke in tennis at the elbow, is a third class lever system, and this is how we would draw it. LEF. Load at one end, effort in the middle, which is being caused by the bicep contracting, and the fulcrum at the end, which is the elbow joint of the humerus, radius, and ulna. And that's that. Quite a quick way to pick up one mark from this question, just to identify it as the third class lever, and then two additional marks to get the three different components labelled correctly as part of the lever system. So hope you found it useful, and I'll see you again in the next one. Bye for now. We'll be right back.